The raid on Harper's Ferry and the execution of John Brown, of course, came on the eve of an extremely pivotal American election, to say the least. You all know the Republican Party had a good showing in 1856 and nearly won its first time out. Now, what will this Republican Party be by 1860? How will it threaten the South? Will it threaten the South? John Brown's raid on Harper's Ferry and his execution were a template all into that next spring as the American political culture held its conventions and nominated candidates and prepared for an election that now people said might decide whether the Union would hold together or not. The Democrats held their convention in late April, early May, in the worst possible place they could hold it. They had scheduled it well ahead of time in Charleston, South Carolina. Charleston was a hotbed of Southern rights and Southern nationalism, if you want to call it that, and Southern secessionism. Already it was. Now, the front-running candidate of the Democratic Party by 1860, and this man had been working for this for a decade and a half, was, of course, Stephen Douglas of Illinois. Same Stephen Douglas of popular sovereignty fame. But Stephen Douglas had made one slip-up. Well, he made more than one, but he made two really big slip-ups in terms of his fellow Southern Democrats. I mean, he's by far the most prestigious person in their party. But in one of his debates with Abraham Lincoln, one of those incredible debates with Lincoln, the one in Freeport, Illinois, and much ado was made about this. It was almost a throwaway line, although it wasn't thrown away. Lincoln pushed Douglas, and he said, "Do you mean then, Judge Douglas," as he always called him, he would never call him Senator, "Judge Douglas, do you mean then that if the people who settle a Western territory, you know, your popular sovereignty business, what does that really means? The folks can vote it out, right? In spite of what the Dred Scott decision says? Dred Scott decision just said that because of the Fifth Amendment, you cannot stop a person from taking his slaves anywhere he wants." And Lincoln says, but Judge, what's that done to your popular sovereignty? And Douglas says, well, that people can still vote. And if the people vote slavery out, then they vote it out. And his fellow Southern Democrats immediately started writing to him and wiring him and saying, wait a minute, Stephen. Do we live in the land of the Dred Scott decision or not? It became known to Southern Democrats as the so-called Freeport Doctrine. And Douglas kept trying to dance around it, avoid it. In opposition to the so-called Freeport Doctrine and in opposition to Douglas, at this Southern Democrat, at the Democratic Party convention, and by the way, that Democratic Party is, by anyone with his eyes open, the only truly national political party left in America. The hope of saving the Union, just in a political sense, by 1860, was with the Democrats. This Republican Party, as we're soon to see, was a Northern party, almost exclusively. Countering Douglas, Southern Democrats, led by none other than Jefferson Davis, a senator from Mississippi at that point, a long distinguished member of Congress, Secretary of War, Commandant of West Point, and so on, they came up with what they now called a slave code for the territories. That's what they called it. And that slave code for the territories was now to be a protection in the Constitution, an explicit protection in the Constitution of slave ownership anywhere in the Western territories of the United States. They wanted, in essence, not just the Dred Scott decision, Supreme Court case. They wanted a federal, they wanted not just the repeal of the Kansas-Nebraska Act geographical division, not just the Dred Scott case which said a person has the right to take slaves anywhere they wish. They wanted a explicit federal guarantee of the right to slave ownership. and they wanted it to be a constitutional amendment if necessary. Now, this is why the Democratic Party tore itself apart at Charleston. They had a two-thirds rule, so even though Stephen Douglas did muster a small majority of support in the first balloting, he could not win the nomination. And when Douglas's supporters managed to pass a platform without the so-called slave code for the territories, Southern delegates of eight states, they'd all prepared for this, stalked out of the convention. The convention ended, they nominated nobody, and they split into two parties, the Southern Democrats and the Northern Democrats. And everybody knows that when a party does this, it almost guarantees it will lose. And it did. The Southern Democrats agreed to reconvene in Baltimore on June 18. And the Northern Democrats reconvened, the so-called official Democratic Party reconvened in Baltimore on June 18. They nominated Stephen Douglas, no surprise. They called themselves the National Democrats. The Southern Democrats of those eight Southern states, it's the Deep South, met in Richmond, Virginia shortly after that and nominated John C. Breckinridge of Kentucky. Slaveholder, but a moderate, known to be a kind of an old Henry Clay moderate, although he'd never been a Whig, to be their candidate for president. And by the end of June 1860, the Democratic Party had two candidates, Breckinridge, the Southern Democrat, Douglas, the Northern Democrat. Now, the Republican Party had its convention in Chicago. It was an extraordinary convention. There had never been one quite like it in American history. It was raucous. There were just parades and waves of people, sometimes hired, sometimes induced in by lots of drink, to come into the so-called wigwam, which was this big convention hall of a kind they had constructed in Chicago. It was sometimes called the Shouters Convention because these people were sort of hired to shout for one candidate or the other. What fun and nonsense it must have been. The leading candidate of the Republicans, of course, was William H. Seward. Seward of New York, long-term time senator from New York, had strong anti-slavery credentials as a good, solid free soiler, and indeed even had fairly strong abolitionist ties. And he'd been there at the creation of the Republican Party. And he had a kind of a machine of a sort. But there was this strange insurgency out of Illinois behind a favorite son named Abraham Lincoln. It wasn't all that well known, even though he had become fairly well known in his run against Stephen Douglas in 1858. But of course, he'd lost that election narrowly to Douglas in 58. He'd had one term in the U.S. House back in the late 1840s during the Mexican War, and then he lost on his attempt at re-election. 2 years in the House of Representatives, a rather inexperienced, but it turns out, brilliant politician. The platform of that Republican Party, which was very important, in these years people were reading platforms, believe it or not. Today, platforms, schmatforms, right? Southerners were really reading the Republican Party platform. The platform of 1860 was a little broader and had somewhat more moderate appeals in it than their 1856 deeply free soil platform had had. They made big appeals in 1860 to create higher federal tariffs, to create free homestead law in the West. These are all appeals, you know, to the common man, and to the rights of immigrants. Because the Republicans were now successful by the late 1850s at all but dissolving that nativist party, the Know-Nothings, or the American Party, and were drawing most nativists, not quite all, but most nativists into the Republican Party. And they'd managed this strange marriage of a kind of a pro-immigrant platform. At the same time, they're attracting nativists who are as worried about slavery as they were about Catholics. They appealed to a certain anti-Southern feeling. There's no question about that. Now, Lincoln got the nomination largely because, one, the convention was held in his home state. Two, William H. Seward had made a fair number of enemies around the Republican coalition. He was in the limelight too long, in a sense, you could argue politically. And a lot of Republicans were looking for a candidate who seemed more moderate than that abolitionist Seward. They wanted to run in this election in a way that, you know, the Upper South, maybe the border states, would actually support them. And this Lincoln, you know, man, after all, he was born in Kentucky, you know. He's kind of a border state guy himself. Seward's just a Yankee. So there's a certain irony in that Lincoln got some support because he wasn't seen as abolitionist. Now, that isn't necessarily as true. Lincoln was on record all over the place as saying such things as he had in 1859. I quote him, "Republicans believe that slavery is wrong, and they insist and will continue to insist upon a national policy which recognizes it and deals with it as a wrong. There can be no letting down on this." Reasonably clear language. Oh dear, I gotta move him. Sorry, Abe. There you are. This is Matthew Brady's famous photograph that he took on the day of Abraham Lincoln's Cooper Union speech in New York, a speech that introduced Lincoln to the East, and according to Harold Holzer in a recent book, made Lincoln president. Now, that's a bit overstated, but it's pre-beard. He didn't grow the beard till the next year. But the crisis was so serious now with this Northern anti-slavery free soil Republican Party, two Democratic parties, one Southern, one Northern, splitting themselves, that a group of American politicos got together practically overnight, late that summer, 1860, and decided to run yet a fourth candidate. His name was John Bell of Tennessee, and they called themselves the Constitutional Union Party. They drew together some old Whigs. The Whig Party doesn't exist anymore. There's still some old Whigs looking for a political home. They drew some nativists and know-nothings. And they drew border state people who were just frightened of how this mess was possibly going to destroy the Union. Their platform was extremely simple. They pledged themselves simply to, quote, defense of the Union and enforcement of the law. Now, who could be against that? They were for the Union and law, both nice things. And almost unbelievably, this party had quite a few followers overnight. Now, when the election came, and I'll go back to the map if you'll forgive me. It's worth looking at some quick numbers, and more than worth it. This is one of the great four-way races for the presidency in American history. We've only had really one or two other four-ways. 1912 was a four-way. And of course, that guarantees almost you're going to have a minority president. That is, the one who wins is not going to win a majority, and that's exactly what happened in this case. Now, Abraham Lincoln, the Republican, was not even on the ballot in 10 slave states. Republicans weren't even put on the ballot in all of the Deep South. Lincoln carried all of the Northern states in all of their electoral votes except three in New Jersey. Breckinridge, the Southern Democrat, carried all the slave states except parts of the Upper South. Virginia, Kentucky, Tennessee, and Missouri. Well, you can see that on that map. John Bell, the Constitutional Union candidate, this overnight party that just said, please save the Union, whatever it takes. We need a new national compromise. Bell won Virginia, Kentucky, and Tennessee, Upper South. Stephen Douglas, who'd been kind of running for president in his heart for 15 years, won only one state, Missouri. Lincoln received only 26,000 votes in the South, in all the slave states. He received only about 40% of the total raw vote. 60% of Americans who voted in 1860, and they voted in huge percentages, 75-80% turnout, 60% of all those who voted did not vote for Abraham Lincoln. But he was elected. And now, of course, the question was, what would the South do?